And then the other piece that I like to look at is the legacy function equivalent value proposition. What I mean by that is, let's take BitShares, for example. BitShares basically offered a platform for you to conduct your own trades using digital assets. And when I compare a legacy function to that, I look at something like E-Trade, where it costs $9.99 or whatever it is. I guess it's free technically in the case of Robinhood, but let's say it's $9.99. So if it costs 2.6 BitShares or something to make a trade, then that 2.6 BitShares kind of has an equivalent legacy value of $9.99. And if they are able to scale their system up to those levels, that is what the eventual price could technically become. So the technology and the team. We obviously have the capability and the experience of the founders. How has this team built anything before? Are they capable of building something in a new decentralized landscape? Network effect from the founding members' connections, how big are their networks? Do they have the right people to spread their tokens into the right hands to ensure that value creation? Are they building a great usable product? And what types of people are promoting it? You know, is it a celebrity, or is it somebody who is technically savvy, who is really aware of how these systems work? Warren Buffett actually said, when in the short term, the stock market is a popularity contest, but in the long term, it's a weighing machine. Or another way to put that is, eventually there will be a flight to quality. You know, if you have Floyd Mayweather promoting your token, sure, you'll probably get some people buying it real quick. But what happens when the product isn't the best product, something way better comes out? Eventually, the hype of Floyd or whatever the celebrity of the day is will go away, and all those tokens will move into the projects that are actually doing something. Not to say that they might not. But. And then, of course, there's the community. The community aspect is really how I got involved in all of this. Lots of community management, lots of evangelism, getting people to understand the message behind these crypto projects. So your community really is your value proposition. They're your user base. They're the people who are giving you feedback. They're maintaining and building your system's value by using it, by spreading your message, etc. You can incentivize your community through bounties and rewards to get them to participate even more, or reward them for the participation that they're already doing. I think there sometimes can be a misalignment where people only are working for the tokens and don't actually care about the products, which can be a negative sort of situation sometimes. But if you can target the right people for the right reasons, find the right people to work for your project, then everybody has aligned interests and there's increased opportunities for everyone doing the things that they would like to do. So, when I look at different models that are kind of available today, you know, there's constantly new types of models being thought out, being iterated through, being prototyped. You can have a few that are the most prevalent ones across the network. The first is a consumption or utility token, something that you use within an application, something where the price fluctuates from that stake to utilization ratio directly. And where more users and more transactions grow the value of the network. So Ethereum is obviously something like this because it requires gas for every transaction. Gollum is hopefully going to be something like this once it's out and going. And then SingularityNet was recently released project that is focused on artificial AGI. I'll say artificial general intelligence for the public consumption, which is a very vital proposition, so the artificial intelligence doesn't solely end up in the hands of the extremely wealthy and create an even further kind of dichotomous situation. The next model is the membership models. Token ownership is kind of participation and support in that network. If I'm buying these tokens, I probably want to become a member or reutilize it, or at least think that other people are going to utilize it. You get a subscription to a service, something like the SALT model, for example. You pay a certain number of SALT tokens and you get access to the service. Primal Base, the one on the left, you gain access to a series of co-working spaces. that you can go to forever just by purchasing one of their tokens. And then Legends Room is like a strip club in Las Vegas that you can go to if you have 5,000 tokens. You can go to the VIP rooms in the strip club. But I think although those two models might not be applicable for every type of person, it shows like what different opportunities there are to design systems around these types of models. You know, whether you like going to strip clubs or swimming pools. And then there's the revenue sharing models. Now, these are kind of really debatable at this, or kind of turbulent topic at this point in time, because revenue sharing models sort of have a kind of dividend proposition where you're returning some of the value to the token holders, which implies that it's most likely security. Now, obviously, the regulation is changing so much every day that it's hard to keep up with the whole situation. But basically, if there is, if there is a sort of return, then there has to be, a security token, and you have to have credit investors. There might be some challenges for some projects that did things in a certain way down the road. But some examples that exist right now are Populous, which kind of did the invoice financing, token card, which is a really cool model where a portion of each transaction kind of goes into a pool and your tokens are representative of a portion of that pool. And then there's the KuCoin exchange, which takes a percentage of the fees collected from all the different exchanges and distributes it to the KuCoin shares token holders. So you get like 200 transactions every day from all the different tokens in their network based on the transaction fees, which is kind of a hard thing to manage, but they're doing it. And then kind of the last sort of style of model that I really enjoy to discuss is staking models. Models where you have like a base token that you can then put into kind of these sub sort of networks where you can allocate your interests. I see money as energy, I see money as value, I see money as time, I see money as attention. It's kind of a combination of all of these things synthesized together. And when you have when we have the ability to stake our money or our value or our time or whatever into systems of our choice rather than being imposed, rather having a system imposed on us, rather, with no opt-out, like we've had with traditional fiat money. When we kind of realize that there are alternatives, that there are new systems that we can start to participate in, then we have a lot more power with essentially how the future goes. Because all of the wealth can be staked into systems that we actually care about, that resonate with our interests, rather than potentially ones that don't. I found that it's becoming a lot less challenging now, but money's a very ingrained pattern because it's been the same for so long. It comes in there's a very like fear place about it where money is kind of security, money is safety, and the idea that it can change is very unsettling for a lot of people. So I think when we do have one of these base tokens, and we can have the option to choose which systems we want to participate in, which ones we want to stake in, these systems need to relate to us more than just on an economic sort of basis. It should really relate on an emotional level as well. Is this something that I actually care about? Is this something that I want to see succeed? Is there something beyond profit motive going on here? Because ultimately, those are the sustainable models. And what I've found from my own experience is that profit-driven motive does not ultimately lead to the same sort of satisfaction as emotional resonance and helping other people. So, in a world where we do have these like thousands, potentially tens of thousands, or even eventually millions of tokens, we kind of run into this problem where they all are in their own individual silos and nobody can understand where these value propositions of each one are coming from. You don't know if the value is being manipulated by a couple of players. You don't know how many people are even holding tokens. Somebody can just set up a bunch of different wallets and say that there's a huge community and cause a big commotion. And somebody could come in from outside that system, think something's really great is going on, but in fact it could all be just a big scam. So this is kind of where projects like Bancor or the Kyber network come into play, where you have these sort of decentralized global liquidity networks that have market-making functions and algorithmically price all of the different tokens that are built on top of that network. These systems allow for instant convertibility, instant changeability, and instant liquidity. So if I start up a token, I know for sure, and everybody else knows for sure, what the value of that token is, what I can get for that token at any time, based on a certain level of reserves within that smart contract. So, this is just kind of a short overview of the possibilities of tokens, but John Maynard Keynes sort of proposed a lot of the Bancor model that Bretton Woods said in the letter to Roy Harrad in 1938 that economics is a science of thinking in terms of models joined to the art of choosing models which are relevant to the contemporary world. Today, now that we have the freedom to design our own models and choose the systems that we want to participate in, to me at least, it's really exciting that we can design whatever we want and really be a part of the beginning of this new decentralized financial world. Thank you.